conclude today's conference, we're going to hear from a very important and interesting side of this business, which is from the golf course architects who design our courses and have to address the water efficiency issues as well. Our first speaker is Bill Love, president of W.R. Love Incorporated. He has 30 years plus experience in designing golf courses and also is the author of An Environmental Approach to Golf Course Development. He is going to address more of the domestic related issues with golf courses and water, and his talk is Designing Golf Course for Water Conservation. Bill?
Thanks, Paul. I just want to start by thanking the USGA for putting this summit on. It's long overdue. Those of us in the golf industry struggle with water issues every day and are always thinking about ways to conserve water. So the fact that we're all coming together with regulatory people and academic people, it's just really a great opportunity. So I hope that we move forward from this conference, talk about implementation, how do we make it happen is going to be very important. But they've asked me to talk a little bit about design issues as far as water conservation is concerned. I'm not going to dwell on drought conditions and all that kind of thing because you've heard that for 2 days. But what I'm going to do is talk about what impacts us as designers when we're looking at a new golf course. Let's see if I got this right. What do you do? Which? Huh? This one? I always start with a little bit of a history lesson. It's only going to take a minute, but the first golf courses that we know of, whether you think they were in Finland or the British Isles, wherever it may be, were just really discovered. People walked through the links land, discovered where good holes would be, and used the existing grasses. The soils were great, and they just evolved out of the existing landscape. You just played it and as you found it. It was the environment that drove design. That was the first process, was discovering golf holes and letting the environment dictate to it. You simply found it as it exists, and there was some pretty dramatic terrain, so it made for some pretty good golf courses. But as golf moved away from the coast and we got into a lot of different types of landscapes, the environment still was the foundation for design because you had to find sites that were eminently suitable for golf. That meant having great natural features, suitable topography. We didn't have a lot of earth moving equipment back then. You had to have great soils. Drainage is so key. When I first got in the business, there was a battle cry that said there's three important design issues that you have to deal with when you're creating a great golf course. Drainage, drainage, and drainage. So we're thinking about that. So you have to have great soils to do it. Now we're thinking about how do we get water onto a golf course, how do we retain it, but we also have to drain it. But anyway, ease of construction, all those things lent to golf courses that were built. Again, the environment dictated to what we were doing. And irrigation, if there was any, was minimal. Early course designers, they understood that a great site could yield a great golf course. And they understood also that existing natural systems, topography, climate, drainage, vegetation, all worked together to create a piece of property that had this inherent character to it, that you could weave a golf course into it, lay a course lightly on the land that had a lot of character and was a great test of golf. Back in the day, they weren't burdened with regulation. I use that word fondly. But at the same time, they practiced sustainable design because they were dealing with existing systems. The fact that these golf courses, many of them have been in existence for 100 years, 80 years, is evidence that it really was sustainable design, or they wouldn't still be around today. Today, though, we have some different issues that we have to take care of when it comes to design. Obviously, we want to create the greatest test of golf that we can. We want to be able to meet the needs of our clients when we design them. We need to be environmentally sensitive at the same time. It is our job at this point to practice resource conservation. That includes water conservation. We have to be eminently aware of environmental issues because if we're not, we're going to run into a regulatory process that chews us up and spits us out. We have to understand the economic viability of developing a course today because we have been talking about sustainability, weaving that term into this conversation for 2 days, And it's true, you have to understand how you're going to operate a golf course, how much it's going to cost to build it, how much it's going to cost to operate it, because if you don't have economic viability, I don't care how much water you're throwing or not throwing, you're not going to have a successful, venture. I throw this last one, affordability, in because as we as designers have come out of this last recession and we're seeing a great modification to the way new golf courses are going to be built, it was touched on this morning about the models that developers use for golf courses now. If we don't create golf, and I promise I'm not going to get on soapbox very much, but I do think that affordability in golf is important. When we get into conferences, when we get into discussions about what's going on with golf today, we always hear that it takes too long to play it and it's not fun. You know, it takes too long, it's too hard, and it costs too much. Those are the three factors. So getting back to golf courses that we can play, have fun, and afford to play and not take all day to do it is all intertwined with water conservation. Let me see if I can show you how that works. This slide I just put up because today, while in the past you could wander around and find sites that produce great golf courses, today a lot of times as architects we're given a site saying, here it is, this is where we want to build the golf course. Now we have to figure out how to make that work. We do that through site analysis, and water conservation is based on site analysis. Whereas in the past, a golf course may have evolved, or you picked a site that was ideal for it. Now when you're faced with a site that may not be, as we say, ideal, we're going to figure out through analysis how we can make that site best work to accommodate a golf course with the least amount of expense and resources. You have to do that through a lot of field reconnaissance. We're very fortunate today that we have a lot of scientific data that we can apply to a site. We have a lot of people that we bring in on a team of consultants to provide us with the type of information that we need in order to make the correct decisions. But you have to fully understand the existing natural systems that are at work on that site before you start to make design decisions. Because if all your design decisions are made in the blind and they run counter to the existing natural systems that are at work, you're going to not only have a problem with how the golf course functions, it's going to cost you a lot more money to operate it, and you're going to run again into a regulatory process that is probably not going to appreciate what you're trying to do. Site analysis encompasses a lot of different things. I'm not going to dwell too long on each one, but I want you to understand the width and breadth of the things that we look at when we're trying to determine how a site functions before we even get there. Climatic data obviously is the first thing that we start with. You want to understand what climate zone you're working in, what the characteristics of that zone are, how much rainfall is going to be available. Even then, when you get down to the microclimate of a site, and believe me, it can differ from one side of a valley to the other. So you have to understand what the specific site conditions are on that. Sun orientation is important, prevailing winds is important, temperature ranges are important. All of those have an impact on how you design golf holes. Topography is sort of the place where we always start. You know, we say there's two things that we'll talk about. I'll get to the next one in a minute. But we want to know what the ground is doing automatically, because that leads us to make decisions about how to build a golf course that's playable. And you're going to see me as I talk about this, that there are two things that you have to always be considered. With water conservation, you have to equally consider the playability of the golf course. So elevation, slopes, orientation, what kind of topography you have, the affordability factor comes in. If the slopes aren't appropriate for regular just putting a golf hole out without modification, you immediately start to ring up your earthwork calculator and how many cubic yards you have to move. Once you start moving cubic yards of dirt, you're getting into subsoil that may not be as conducive to growing turf as the existing soil structure was. So there's a lot of things to consider. This map is the one that's really the most important. If you're starting to think about water, then you have to understand how water is working and flowing across that site. Now, we talked yesterday, Tim touched on it for a minute, about a larger context. If your site is in a bigger watershed, then you have to understand how the water moves through your site. Some sites, though, are on a smaller watershed, maybe at the top of the watershed, so they're sort of self-enclosed. In this particular case, this map, that was what was going on this site. So you have to understand exactly where the water is going. It lets you know where you potentially can impound water. It lets you know what the patterns of runoff are going to be, so you know what parts of the site may retain water longer than other sites. And it's going to tell you, again, from an environmental standpoint, where you're going to have to employ buffers, where you're going to have to stay out, and how your irrigation patterns may have to start to evolve. Water availability and quality, you could say, well, even before you look at a topo map, find out if you have any water availability, because if you don't have any water, why are you even going through the design exercise? And this day and age, you know, you're looking at various sources for supplying water. Rainfall and surface drainage is certainly one of them. Groundwater is one that is becoming more highly regulated, and rightfully so, as you hear about aquifers and the depletion of aquifers and the impact that you have. And believe me, I've been through enough planning and zoning commission meetings where you're talking about drilling a well and there's an agricultural lobby that shows up at the meeting. Where that water is coming out of the ground is a huge political issue. Water bodies, existing water bodies, if they happen to be on your property, that's a pretty good thing. You may not be too regulated on them. If they happen to be going on the periphery of your property and are communally owned, i.e. a river, then withdrawal permits may be a thing of the past as far as that's concerned. You may not be able to take water out of a flowing stream. It just becomes very difficult. Water quantity is what it's all about. You're going to have a very basic understanding of how much water is available. Now, if you say, well, we got all the water we need, well, it's incumbent upon you at that time to say, well, we may have all we need, but what do we really need to have? And then you start to weigh that against how much is available. And the quality is also important. If you have water that has got a lot of contaminants in it, or it's got to be treated tremendously, you need to understand that aspect of it as you begin to think about irrigation on the golf course. I'm not going to get into this because we could spend a week on environmental issues, but if you don't understand what the environmental impacts, what the constraints and opportunities are from an environmental standpoint on your site, then irrigation and water conservation become a moot point because you're not going to get anywhere with it. It all works together as a part of the natural system on the site. Soils, we look at soils because the composition of the existing soils that are on the ground right now, how long have they been in cultivation or how long have they not been in cultivation? But generally, undisturbed soils will contain better growing conditions than if you're going to go through and start scraping away topsoil and getting down to clay soils or something like that. Drainage characteristics are critical. Whether you're building a golf course on a sand pile or it's on a slab of clay, the drainage characteristics of the soil will dictate incredibly to the way you irrigate the golf course. How much topsoil you have is going to dictate whether or not you have to amend the soil, and even things like depth to bedrock. Superintendents that maintain golf courses in a hot climate in the summertime that happen to be only a foot or two above bedrock are going to tell you that in the summertime it can fry your turf grass. Vegetative cover is very important. You've seen a lot of slides and a lot of discussion about native vegetation, and a lot of us in the business talk about this constantly. Ted and I were talking the other day at lunch. Native vegetation, existing vegetation on the site, you have to review it from a couple of standpoints. If it's been there and it's been in succession, or that's what the site has evolved to, and there's no irrigation falling on the site, only what's coming out of the site, out of the sky rather, then you have to think that that vegetation is doing pretty well on its own. So how can you incorporate that kind of area on a golf course, I mean on a site, into a golf course so that you don't bring any irrigations to the table? But at the same time, while we're looking at all of that, we have to consider whether or not we have invasive species present on site, endangered species, because these are going to be regulated or present opportunities to mitigate those situations and then actually improve the site, and that may also have an impact on water conservation. Habitat is the same thing. Again, I won't get into this in any detail, but I'd say about 12 or 15 years ago, when we felt as designers we were finally getting into a good understanding of how wetlands and environmental issues worked, you know, it was very funny. I don't remember who it was, but I really wish I did. Someone in one of these conferences looked at me and said, you know what, Bill? Water is going to be the wetlands of today 10 years from now. And sure enough, it's come to pass. We had a brief stop with habitat issues as far as the regulatory process was concerned, but really now that prediction has come true. Water are the issues that we have to deal with. So site analysis, when you're all is said and done, leads to what we call in the business a constraints and opportunities map, or rather, you understand the constraints and opportunities of any site that you're about to work on. So you look at, again, what the topography is going to offer you, where your water is coming for us, and what the source and quality of it is. You know, well, I'll get into it in a minute when we get to a water slide, but regulated areas, construction and maintenance issues. As designers, we have to understand completely what that product is going to, when we turn it over to the superintendent or the developer or the owner, because if we haven't built in the most efficient systems in this day and age, an operator is going to know that immediately, and the superintendent is going to know that immediately, and it's going to come right back and say, we just simply didn't do a good enough job. It's incumbent on us, again, too, to provide an environmental enhancement whenever we can, and certainly we have every opportunity on almost every site to do that. But layered across all of this is the playability, the aesthetics, and a great golf experience. Because while you may improve the bottom line, you may provide water conservation, you may be environmentally responsible, if you have a golf course that isn't fun to play, isn't relatively attractive to look at, and it isn't affordable, then you're probably not going to have a good product. So these are all the things that we're looking for when we go into design for water conservation. It's pretty much the same thing that I've just been talking about in considerations in site analysis. But now I've put the bullet at the top to engage the imagination and accommodate players of all levels, because this is going to dictate to how we lay out the golf holes, where we put turf areas, and how we maintain those turf areas. All the rest of these things are things that we automatically build in. We have to be efficient with our maintenance. But the last one is important too, that we have a natural appearance and a regional context. Long gone is the era, I believe, that when golf courses tried to create a links-style golf course in a forested upland in the state of New York. If you're doing that kind of thing, you are bucking the natural systems that exist, and you're going to build expense into the golf course automatically. So as we get going and we're armed with all of our information, the first thing a designer is going to do is route the golf course. And now when you've got all of this information in the back of the head, you got all your analysis maps pasted up on the wall, and you start to lay out golf holes. You're not only worried about the diversity of the golf holes that you create, you're not only worried about the character that each one of these golf holes is going to have, you want to know what the water is doing on each one. Is it running off too quick if I put it there? Is it not running off fast enough? Because again, you want that beautiful in between. It can't be droughty, it can't be dry, overly dry, let's say, but at the same time, it can't be soggy and wet. So all of these things come into consideration as you route that golf course. And believe me, if there's more time spent on any one thing other than routing as designers, I think the other guys here would agree, we spend a lot of time figuring out the best place to put golf holes to meet all of these various things, the requirements of all these things that I've talked about. But now we get back into the water and the availability of water. You have to know, as you head into the design process, where is this water going to come from? Not only from an economic standpoint, say for example you do want to use recycled water, what is that cost going to be to get it to the site? Where you locate a pump station on a site, how much infrastructure you have to put in to get a water supply to an impoundment area. Are you going to have to build impoundments? Henry touched on it earlier this morning about the cost of building ponds. A lot of times, though, we can balance that because you have to generate dirt in order to build golf holes because you want to get everything up to guarantee that it's draining somewhat. But so that can be a balancing act, but you have to build these things in order to provide a source for water. Ideally, you want to have it in a pond and draw it out of a pond. You'll notice that I haven't had anywhere on any of these slides public water as a source of water. In my opinion, and this is only me, but Rick can make the same comment, if you're relying on public water as your source of water to design a golf course, don't even bother, because at some point it's not going to be sustainable, and it's not going to fall in the hierarchy of priorities that a water district is going to have. You may be the best manager in the world, but I'm talking about a new golf course. and going in and wanting to do it. I've been up against too many ag lobbies and so forth that golf just takes a back seat as far as the priority for the use of water. But if you can find a source of supply that you either control it or you have ownership of it or you can generate it, then that's an entirely different story. I put this slide in because sometimes we lose track of what we're designing into a golf course and how that impacts our use of water on a golf course. If we do features that are difficult to maintain, a lot of times they impact playability. They may not get us to the bottom line that we want to do. But again, feature design needs to be compatible with an existing landscape the same way that the use of water and drainage patterns is compatible with an existing landscape. If you are forcing features into a piece of ground that you may want to do it, in the past that was something that we did as architects, well I didn't, but anyway, you want to do something now that is compatible with the existing site. It's going to reduce your irrigation requirements ultimately. It's going to reduce your maintenance requirements ultimately. Now we get into the topics that you've been hearing over and over again, and that is reducing high maintenance areas on a golf course. This is probably the most significant way to reduce your water requirements, but if it's not done properly, it will backfire on you big time. If you're not taking the high maintenance areas out in the right places, I mean leaving them in the right places so that people can play the game, and certainly the discussion yesterday from Chris about playing maintenance down the middle is absolutely true. But the problem with that is that 80% of golfers don't play it down the middle. They hit it sideways, backwards, you name it, it's all over the place. So if you're trying to do a golf course that can accommodate all players, whether you're a scratch player or a 30 handicap, you have to understand the zone of play on a golf hole from side to side all the way. And to me, the key becomes not so much what's down the middle, because you know how to deal with that. It's how you deal with everything that's from the just outside the middle out. So maintaining playability and pace of play is crucial to the successful operation of a golf course. Turfgrass selection and the use of indigenous plants. We always work with the green section when we're going into new golf courses to try to determine. We draw on their agronomic knowledge. We may even have an agronomist on staff, but we need to investigate and understand what breeds of turf grass, what types of turf grass have been most successful for that type of microclimate, and exactly for how we're going to try to maintain it. And we want to have the best conditions in that grass for drought and disease, make sure that they're as resistant as they possibly can be. And even though you may say from a marketing standpoint, we want to do this or do that to compete with the golf course down the street, in this day and age, you have to understand and think about what product you're putting out there. Is it going to be sustainable? Because the guy that has the striped up bent grass fairways up the road in an arid climate may not be in business as long as you are if you've selected your turf grasses to survive in a climate where they're really well adapted. Conservation areas, in my opinion, are a huge part of the character of a golf course. They, in essence, are areas where you simply take them out of maintenance. Now, in some courses, I remember when I've been to a few places that employed what they called native areas, and the superintendent would tell me, we spend more time maintaining the native areas than we do on the golf course. That, to me, is not what we call a conservation area. A conservation area is a place that you can take it out of maintenance and in some circumstances just let it succeed naturally and then see where it goes from there. If you're in an environment where you're going to have a lot of woody plant materials and eventually it will fall into forest, then you may have to think about that from a standpoint of wind circulation and so forth. But otherwise, you should just leave it alone and not worry about it. But again, these areas have to be in spots on your golf course that aren't going to come into play. Good to look at, fun to drive by, great for the wildlife that it maintains, but you're never in there stomping around trying to find your golf ball. Irrigation for water conservation. We've heard so much good information today about irrigation technology, but there's also a common sense factor to it. And the comment that was made yesterday about increasing irrigated areas, Well, anyway, I don't know where Greg is sitting there. And we all, our eyebrows kind of went up for a minute. And I understand what he's saying, is that you're using more accurate heads to dispense water more accurately, possibly over a larger section of ground. But I kind of disagree with that, to the point that you can have the technology that you have in a system today and still reduce the area that you irrigate at all. Because if you design it properly and you know where balls are going to go, or you're using the right grasses to sustain a secondary rough or an out-of-play area, then you don't need the irrigation necessarily. Now, that's fine for me to say that in an ideal world, but when you're up against a client or you're up against a developer that wants to sell a certain product, and the guys this morning touched on it for sure, if you're dealing with an HOA or you've got an existing golf course with an existing membership, this practice of browning up a golf course or naturalizing a golf course is a very difficult thing to overcome if it's not a design exercise. The worst thing that you can do is go in and piecemeal native areas on a golf course. It has to be designed so that it falls into the natural systems of the site. It has some natural inherent character to it. It looks like it belongs out there. But with irrigation systems, how you control it is obviously very important. Soil sensors are a great thing. And we, you know, they still are not that prominent out in the industry. So the more we use those, the better it is. Weather stations are very good. Zone coverage is something, it's a terminology that's a little different than what Dana was talking about. The way I use it is that you specifically design a system to be cut back in zones based on where you want to water and where you don't want to water. Now, you can overlay the zone technology that he's talking about on top of that even further, because once you reduce it in a proactive way just to get down your water requirements, even within that zone, you can then let your water sensors tell you where you have to apply water and where you may not. The ideal thing is that you're going to have absolute minimal coverage. So, how does all of this work together? I guess my bottom line is that we talk about all of these various things, and each one is a great technique, and I urge everybody that maintains a golf course or is considering developing a golf course to incorporate these things, because it's like the old battle cry with environment. You know, if you put up one bird box, it's better than no bird boxes. If you're conserving a little bit of water, it's better than conserving no water. But I say the challenge to all of us is that how do we conserve a lot of water? Well, to me, you do it by employing all these techniques, and you do it all the way through the design process. This is a case study that I'm providing. By the way, it's in this book. We brought a copy of this. This is a book that the American Society of Golf Course Architects offers up. It's all about how you design a golf course from an environmental standpoint. If we were writing this today, it would be from a sustainable standpoint, and water conservation would be the subtitle. But there's a lot of information about how what I'm talking about today and what we do in providing water conservation in this book. There's a supply of them somewhere in the back, isn't there, Jim?
Yeah, it's on the registration.
So please grab a couple copies as you go out and see if there might be some information that you find interesting. On this particular site, this was for a developer. We came through a routing and a concept analysis that said that we couldn't integrate housing into it, but their model said that they still needed the amenity, so we became a core-style golf course and we put housing around it. This was a very enlightened developer, so we were lucky to be able to work with them. But investigating it, they said, well, we've got to have golf. That's what we need to make our economics work. And we're like, okay, well, then we start to investigate it, and we come to find out there's no groundwater available. We got a river running right beside it, but we're not going to be able to get any withdrawal permit. And so we're kind of scratching our heads, but we started to investigate the topography, and knowing that in this area in Virginia, we're getting 44 to 48 inches of rainfall per year, and that we had a maximum drought cycle, at least historic data. Now, remember, this is a couple years old, so it may be invalid as far as a maximum drought period. In other words, what's the longest you're going to have to go without getting any rain? Because then we look at the topography of the site, and it turned out that 95% of that site drained to 2 points down at the lower end of the site. So with all of that, then we designed a collection system and a series of impoundments to capture all of that rainfall. And the only thing that we irrigate that golf course with is rainfall. But in order to make that work, we had to cut down the irrigation requirements. So out of 100, I don't know, this translates, I don't know why it's so out of deal. But anyway, out of 170 acres, this is the number that you want to look at, is highly maintained areas was 27 acres and then intermediate maintenance of 30 acres on top of that. So we're really throwing irrigation into 57 acres on that golf course out of 187. 54 acres went back into conservation with no irrigation. 44 acres never got disturbed in the first place and took no irrigation. So but the point for this working all came back to the selection of turf grasses that we used. And it was a very interesting exercise that we went through, again with the green section, as we wandered around and said, why are we trying to find a grass to put into these outer rusts, because they're everywhere. Let's go over to this pasture on that 1,000-acre farm right near here, find out what they're growing with no irrigation, and we'll use that. And certainly we did, and we found out what kind of vegetation was in the pasture. We brought that mix back, we enhanced it a little bit, but it was very common plant material and turf grass that we were using, and it required no irrigation. But the key to it was that it stayed very low to the ground so that you could find a golf ball. Because as we advocate firm and fast, you better understand the impact that that has on the way your golf course plays. You think we hit it longer now? Dry up your golf course and you'll see how long people actually do hit it. So you have to be prepared for where those golf balls are gonna go, and you can't make that high play area where everybody's gonna hit it. But you certainly can concentrate it in, say, this 57 acres, but those 30 acres that are outside of that, you can walk in and find a golf ball and hit it all day long, and it takes no irrigation whatsoever. So all of these things are what we did, the turf grass selection, reducing the irrigation coverage. Under normal conditions, we predicted how much water we would have to use. Once the system was in place and they operated the golf course, they were able to come right out of the blocks at 20% less than what was anticipated. The superintendent, knowing what the weather cycles are, and he constantly has to adjust it, is very proactive, and immediately when he starts to head into what is considered the dry season, he starts to cut back his irrigation. In that circumstance, he lowers his irrigation requirements by 40%. When drought conditions start to persist and his lake levels are going down and there's not a cloud in the sky, he cuts his irrigation down to tees and greens, and he and maybe some primary landing areas, and he's only at less than 70% reduction in his golf course irrigation. And again, if he doesn't get any rainfall and recharge his ponds, he may have a trouble, but that's never happened yet. So I don't need to dwell on that too much. The bottom line of my presentation is that all of these techniques that we talk about are great for water conservation, and we should practice them all. But as we move forward in the future, whether we're retrofitting a golf course, and believe me, this type of analysis works the same way on an existing golf course, except that infrastructure is already in place, but we go through the same process. We need to employ all of these technological advances, all of these design processes together in order to maximize our water conservation. So that's all I have for you today, and I'll turn it back over to Paul. There you go.